thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It was sort of an interesting thing. Here, it's not quite industrial analytics, but it's something that I've actually been getting my students to look at for the last, for their sort of capstone project, or projects this year. An area that has actually not been researched before is taking these gadgets we all have, smart devices with their assisted GPS, everybody assumes they're accurate. You know, we've got all these apps pouring out our ears, whether it's a grinder or something like that, which introduces you to see your friend or somebody just across the other side of the room. Which kind of implies that we believe these things are accurate to inches or feet, or maybe within 10 metres, which is the sort of official GPS accuracy. 95% of all locations, in theory, are accurate to within 10 metres. So, because we couldn't find anything, I thought, hey, it'd be real cool, because it gives my students a chance to use analytics, SAS and Excel and SAS Jump and so on. And it helped, they've got to do some fairly clear and careful planning to go capture data, and then to a bit of technicalities to extract it from, you know, inside the photos or what have you. So it's kind of an interesting sort of broad range of capabilities, and it's giving us some interesting answers that no one has really looked at before. I've had something like 12 students working on it. The data I'm going to show you comes from these seven who were kind of the better ones. There are one or two more still waiting to come. And, you know, in terms of amount of data, we've got 2,460 points, which is kind of an interesting amount. And those students were each collecting at least 200 data points. Some were collecting 400 data points, which for a final-year student is kind of an interestingly large amount of data, by and large. And they tend to be a little bit less than that normally, 30, 40 survey questionnaires if you're lucky. But they were really working really hard and came up with quite a lot of data from this lot. Now, the US government claims that the GPS network gives you that 95% are accurate to within 10 metres. There's an organisation called Think Near, which is reporting now on a quarterly basis of what they are finding when looking at advertising, targeting, and so on. And you see those two sets of data? Only 46% of reported locations coming from smart devices and so on are accurate to within 1,000 metres. Now, there's a big difference in 1,000 metres and 10 metres. What's more intriguing is that 10%, this is the latest one, 10% of their reported locations from smart devices are more than 100 kilometres in error. Now, you're using this for marketing and so on, or you're using it for crime and such like, kind of interesting. My students' data is not quite that bad. 85% within about 25 metres, that's indoors and outdoors. But we still have this 2.5%, which is worse than half a mile, or half a kilometre, sorry. And we've got a small number, it's only 3 or 4, 5, 6, 7 points, I forget exactly, in the 1 to 80 kilometre error. But we can't rely on it. And we're going back to some rather interesting points. John Easton, an IBM guy from the UK, did some work back in 2012. And he pointed out that probably by about now, 80% or more of all the data we have around us, big data, social media data, and our corporate data systems, our executive ERP type systems, are still likely to be at least uncertain in their veracity. He's not saying 80% is wrong, but at least 80% of that data we don't actually know whether it's right or wrong, and by how much it's right or wrong. So it's kind of led into this whole thing. And if things had timing had gone differently in the last session, I'd have actually taken you through a set of V's for big data, which my students extended from the classic 3 or 6 to out to 18 or 14. But the problem we have with assisted GPS is very much in the field of veracity. Is it right? Is it wrong? Can we believe it? Can we use it? It's highly variable. If I stand here, and if I were to do it with one or two of my tools I've got on my phone, I will be taken for a wander all over the countryside. It varies all the time. Problem of verification, and also the issues to do with visualization. How do we know how to visualize this location data that helps us make useful decisions when you're trying to use it, whether personally or whether business and industry is trying to use it. And we had some presentations a couple of sessions ago about the question of, you know, automating the reporting of potholes. You know, the guys who are trying to fill potholes kind of rather like to know they're on the right road. I mean, they don't mind if it's not quite here, but it's 10, 20 yards that way or that way. But in the North American system where you have these rectangular or square blocks in your cities, you know, 200 metres is kind of one, two, three blocks north, south, east, or where, away from where you are. And that's kind of problematic. So this characterisation has value and is important. So we looked at what's the reliability, and I'm more interested actually in the consequences. I'm not interested in diagnosing the causes of all of these errors. I mean, the technology guys who can sort of look at whether it's the water vapour in the column out to each of the four satellites or more they're using, or whether it's you've got trees over you or whatever. I'm just interested in what's the characteristics, the profiles, but then what does it do? What are the consequences in terms of governance? The sort of thing that David was talking about, which is all about governance ultimately, because governance requires an understanding of risk. So I want to very briefly introduce some areas that it's being used. I want to give you a little evaluation of the accuracy and then briefly look at the governance question. So we know that people use it in marketing and geofencing. Sometimes that's done at the network level from the cell, but sometimes they're trying to get back inside your devices. There's a lot of recreation use, social media, photo tagging and so on. And yet, you know, you've done all of your photos and you're shoving them onto Google Earth. And I was looking at where we're going to for this conference down in Puerto Rico. And there are some photos around the hotel area which are clearly quite the wrong place by, you know, up to half a mile, a mile. There's one photo on the island, which is a close-up of the bar on the sort of recreational island, which is located about 2 miles away across the sea. Now, there's no way that could have been taken where it was located. We've also got in Europe, the European eCall system, which is being implemented in the next 2-3 years, where car crashes self-report. And they reckon it's somewhere between 100 to 200 metres is the requirement, the accuracy that they need to have. So how many times are vehicles going to be called out to a crash in the wrong place? And of course GPS tagging, because a lot of the criminal services will tag people so to make sure they're at the right place at the right time doing their curfews. Now the triggers, one was this one here, that was where I was at a conference, took some photos, and the bottom left-hand one is 22 kilometres out of position. I was standing in there, in a TK Maxx, and just watching my phone on Maps Plus. And it took me for a walk there, which was about 200 yards away. This one was kind of fascinating, because that was during April. At night time, frequent occasions, my phone goes for a walk, or went for a walk, 400 metres for a couple of hours. Now, I know I didn't go for a walk. I know the phone was in another room, stationed, but I think so. I don't think I had a break in. This one is I took 18 photos, one after the other, indoors over a period of about 5 minutes, and it went for a walk all over the place. And this one is very, very apposite. This is Sunday. I was at the top of Morial by the radio tower. Took a photo, got back down here, connected to the internet, and he said, "Oh, this is where you were." That was where I was. That's where the photo goes. 4.9 kilometres out of base. And that's on the top. Clear visibility, and so on. Interesting thoughts, guys. So what happened? Well, some of the insights that the students have come up with, one is that there's some very, very significant differences between different types of phone. There's the Nexus and there's the iPhone. And you know, the statistics are showing they're pretty seriously different, very reliable, very significant differences between the two. Another one, this was really spectacular. This guy, Victor Hereshny, took two sets of photos, each place, indoors. One was the HTC M8, the blue one, and one was the HTC Desire S, the pink one, which is an early generation. And you can see completely different profiles. But what's more interesting is, this one is spectacularly less accurate. So if you're going to use location services for some purpose, you need to know what generation it is, and otherwise you might have some fun. This one was rather interesting from Farindeep. We talked a little bit about the problems of reflection and so on, and I said it'd be quite interesting if you went out into a car park when it was full and when it was empty, and at exactly the same spot, so have a little investigate. So he went down here, there and there, full and empty, 935 metres error down here. Now when I quizzed him, I thought maybe that's a startup error because he sort of switched his phone on, took a photo down there and there and there. Turned out actually that wasn't the case, because other situations showed that that was not a startup error level of problem. Now this raises some interesting questions. If you are in the police, or you're a spy service, where do you put your little GPS tag that's following the car, so you can follow the car? You put it under the car. That's funny, there's an awful lot of metal between you and all of the satellites around there. So maybe all the spy thrillers are not terribly representative of what really happens. Because, it, you know, low down, empty car park, bog standard type of error level. So there's all sorts of interesting consequences. Now this was the other interesting one from Amna. She didn't do 200 different locations. She did, I think, 14, but she took a photo every minute or so. And look at these profiles. They're all similar. They sort of start off badly, or sometimes start off badly, drop to a sort of reasonable level of accuracy, and then every now and then there's a huge blip. Couple of things going on there. One is that the satellites that you're tracking are going from up there maybe down, so you've got more and more air in between you, which has more and more water vapor, so that's one issue. And you've also got changing lock as well as you switch satellites and so on, probably. But it means you don't have a constant location. So we've found so far in this sort of general exploratory to find out what sort of factors might be involved, some of these sort of things. This is the one where I actually tracked, I actually showed this at SAS Global Forum, because to actually get SAS to produce that picture was kind of interesting. But these were the first 8 readings over a period of about 5 minutes. It then jumped to, where was it, about here, nearly at home, then very briefly went across the road, then it came back down there, then to there, and eventually stabilised after about 10 minutes, roughly speaking, at the correct point. This is the 2600, this is spread across basically Derby, a bit of Derbyshire, and then to Birmingham over there, and what I've tried to represent is the fact that green is comfortably accurate. The yellowy colours are somewhat less accurate, but the red ones, you can see them spread around, are more than 300 metres and outwards. They're a kind of way of visualising some of the questions of this inaccuracy. Overall, well, I covered that, but here's the graph that shows the sort of thing. But these are questions that, in governance, and I don't apologise for posing questions, we don't learn anything if we're told the answers. We stop learning. But if we're given the questions, the sort of things that David was doing with that risk profile, which is just probing to give the auditors the sort of questions that they need. And I'm saying here, okay, if you want to use location-based services, if you want to use location analytics, you need to think about two or three questions. One, what level of accuracy do you need? Because if you need fundamentally 10 metres accuracy permanently, you've got a problem. If you can live out at the half kilometre you're probably okay most of the time, like sort of 90-95% of the time. You don't have to worry too much about the veracity. You still got to, might want to try and find those outliers, because they can be kind of significant sometimes. And then, you know, if you're marketing, and I've had this one occasion, at least in accurate terms, I was on the train, and I was looking at the location, and it put me in the middle of Sheffield, which is 40 miles from where I was. This is kind of not helpful if you are Starbucks trying to advertise to somebody. If you are using a GPS rather than cell-based network infrastructure-based geofencing. So you've got to think carefully about what you're wanting to do. Then you need to think very much about the consequences of this uncertainty about the veracity of the data you're using. To your organisation, because there's, you know, some of the risks there from reputational and legal risks perhaps come to the fore. What about to your customers? You know, if you are advertising, you're just around the corner from my shop, and you manifestly aren't, you know, they're going to lose trust. They're going to get fed up. They're going to treat your adverts as spam rather than as useful. And that comes back again to reputation and other risks. And then if you're in Europe particularly, and quite a lot of other countries, and I guess Canada, but perhaps not so much the USA, the data collection regimes, where you know, you've got issues about holding inaccurate data. If you've personalized it and retained the personalization identity, there can be issues, particularly if you think you might be at risk of being felt by the local police or crime services. You want to have accurate data in there that definitely does not locate you near potential crime scenes. And so there is an issue, potentially, if you want to store personalised data, including this rather inaccurate data about location. So three important questions, I think, if you want to use personalised or unpersonalised location data. And you know, if you, as I was saying earlier, 10 metres, 20 metres, 50 metres probably is okay for pothole reporting. 500 metres might be a serious issue. Even 100 metres, a couple hundred metres could be a problem if it's in the wrong road. So you've got to ask yourself questions about your data and your algorithms and so on. What I'm wanting to do in the future, next year, is to do it with a better standardisation. So rather than exploratory, now I'm going to start real hard with characterisation between different models and standards. I want to control for GPS, cell-based, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth accuracy, so get the kids and students to switch off everything except GPS, then maybe look at Wi-Fi and so on. I'd rather like to get the participation wider out through schools, networks, out through universities, as projects. Steve and I were thinking that it'd be rather fun if by the time everybody turns up at the Big Data Analytics Conference in Puerto Rico, we happen to have 100,000 sets of data points through the academics getting their students to do things for them. Because then we could pour it into what's an analytics and do some really cool stuff there, probably. So, yeah, please volunteer. Well, that's it, folks. Thanks very much.
Great. Any comments?
So if I'm going to be a criminal, I want an older phone so the police won't be able to track where I am.
That kind of sounds right. Or, better still, search location services on the thing.
No, but if I want to deliberately mislead them.
Oh, yeah, you could make that point, yeah, but you don't know where it's going to go inaccurate. That's a real problem. I don't know what's causing why I went at the top of the morale. A couple of days ago, why did it give me 5 kilometres error?
Yeah, I've seen advertisements where insurance companies say, if you'll let us install a GPS on your car, and your driving is good, we'll lower your insurance rates. And I'm thinking, so possession's important, but if they're looking for velocity of driving, the rate at which that location changes then becomes pretty important.
Well,
the question I'm leading to is, it sounds like the devices you're looking at they come along with a cell phone, and I'm wondering if there are different industry standards for companies that are going to be relying on on location information for very specific economical business processes?
That's an interesting question. I would observe that with your average sat-nav, which isn't, I don't think is a GPS, so it's not got all the other cell phone and stuff in it, but what it does have is two fundamental things which are not so well developed in smart devices. One is they have inertial systems in there, which is why when you go into a tunnel and lose GPS, you can, it will still track you. And that's helped by the fact that they use Snap2 logic. So it knows to keep you on the road at all times until it becomes too difficult, which is when you go off the exit, it suddenly realizes after you've got off the exit, when you hadn't told it you were going to, and it sort of, I thought I was on there, but no, it's getting impossible, it jumps suddenly. And they're coming down one of the major roads in the UK last year about this time. There's a new dual carriageway had been built to replace the old one, and it's about 150, 200 metres perhaps over that way. And for some reason, it fed me, it knew that I was on the old road, which ends in the middle of a field, and it was only when it became completely impossible for it to carry on, it suddenly went, and I jumped across. And that was, I think, about 150 metres difference. So, you know, there are times when even those were their full inertial plus Snap2 logic plus everything else kind of has a problem. So quite what's going to happen, and in fact one of the there's a company quite close to Derby where one of our students tends to go for their placement year each year, which actually provides the black boxes for fleet operators to use, and then they provide the service to download, store and process the data so that the fleets know which vehicles being driven well and so on, and security. And one of the things they know they have to do as they collect the data coming from this little black box, which is clearly tuned to be good, is they have to look at the reasonableness of the location data. Otherwise they're going to get cut, lorries suddenly doing 1,000 miles an hour for a bit, which is kind of not really realistic. And so they recognise the veracity problem, and now they're doing logic checks which says, yeah, it's going along there, and suddenly it's sort of over there, and then it's back there, so we can ignore that point. So there's a lot of work that has to be done. And you can do that if you've got this continuous stream. The problem with mobile phones and such like, taking photos and so on, whatever, is we don't necessarily have access to the continuous stream. You know, the app knows, bonk, to report I'm here, but it doesn't have that rest of the stream, so, oh, that's ridiculous.
It was a very good presentation, so thank you very much. I've been aware of this problem in a different context for some time. I was wondering if anybody had done anything with sort of a crowd-based, location-based services. Because part of the problem is you're dealing with a single device, right? So you're dealing with a single device which has an error set, which is presumably different from an error set of somebody So is anybody like working on algorithms that kind of have a voting procedure? Now, I'll give you a specific example where this would be useful. Now, the example you gave was traffic accidents. Traffic accident, you have to be within 200 meters. I would agree. I would disagree. That's completely horseshit. That's not going to work. If you're underneath an overpass, that's completely unworkable. If you're on a basket weave, that's completely unworkable. You need to be within 10 meters, maybe. So that's fine. What if you're something happens, an incident happens, it was a disaster? So building collapses. Building collapses, it attracts crowds. All those people have phones, all those people could be providing location-based services, right? So they could be saying, I'm here, right? I'm taking a picture of this. And some of those will be outliers. But in the aggregate, would it be any more accurate than a signal?
What would probably happen is the telcos would be involved with this, and they can do this at a network infrastructure level, so they're not worried about reporting or trying to get inside your phone to get your AGPS accurate location. What they're doing is they're using the triangulation. I mean, they can make it inside your phone to do the triangulation, or they may do it from network level as well, all the IDs, treating them essentially anonymous. They don't care whose they are, but they can actually see through the cell infrastructure.
Yeah, but they can't tell you anything about the location you're interested in. They only care about the device, right? So they know where the device is and presumably it's attached.
But the reality is that the telcos and even advertising, so if you're say Starbucks for an example, I'm not sure how they do it, but they can actually do the geofencing without getting inside your phone. They can do it at, as I say, the network levels. They've got three cells triangulating, so they can say if you come inside this cell area, then you will receive. We don't care what your phone is reporting. We know from the level which is unarguable, pretty much, that you're within, if you're on 4G, within about 50 to 100 meters.
Yeah, but you're removed from the incident you're actually interested in, right?
Yeah.
So I understand if you're in a car and the insurance company's interested in where you're driving, then this would be a hugely wonderful service, right? But if you're just reporting something because you're a citizen and you're saying that you're outside of that event, then you need to be actively involved in doing that. So that can't be done in... can't be done physically by a telco, and it can't be coordinated fast enough to make any difference with a telco, right? But a crowd could do it. So I'm just wondering if anybody...
Given that my students haven't found anyone who's reported this GPS accuracy problem before...
It's actually quite common.
Everybody knows about it, but no one's characterized it. They've researched quite deeply.
The US government has a large project called GPS Deny that works on this very issue. So, and it's all about inertial navigation, which also doesn't work. and all these things, which are quite annoying to people. Right? I think you framed it in a different way, right? And that is very unique. That's why I'm asking you this question.
Yeah. So now, we haven't actually addressed that problem.
Let me create an example, a sporting event.
Yeah.
Say everybody's going to Skydome to watch FIFA.
Yeah.
You know they're all in Skydome. They're all at this event. And they're all running their FIFA app that somebody's created. So are you saying then you want to be able to say you're sitting in section 108, seat 25?
No, I'm more interested in something like the soccer player is right beside me,
mm-hmm.
right? So that means the soccer player is here, am I right? Well, that's kind of a trivial example, but hey, I see that building over there and it just collapses. I go running towards the building and I say, hey, here I am. And everybody else does that as well, right? So now you kind of have area of influence which you're very interested in.
Yeah, so you mean maybe they tweet them, maybe they, something like that, you mean?
Yeah, but you see that can be...
Again, if they've got location tag service active and they're allowing their photos to be tagged, then in principle, I guess, someone who's looking at the Twitter stream from 1,000 or 10,000 people, whatever, if they were able to take the data quickly enough, in principle, you could be able to pick out the outliers, because you get, it would be quite easy to find, I've got 50 or 100 photos, all the same plus or minus 50 feet.
Right. And you're using a single thing, right? Like just it's geolocation.
Yeah.
But not any sort of photometric data, for example.
Not
so,
no.
So like you have a cell phone, you take a picture of something, if it happens to be a very famous thing, then you would actually be able to know kind of where it is, and then you could have anybody who has a photo like that that is way out there, you know you can discount that data.
Well, cell tower, Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can do lots of things. Anyway,
okay.
I think we need to move on.
Yeah, thanks, Richard. Any